Hey North Coast, we're so glad you're here with us today. My name is Tanner and I'm on the video team here at the Vista campus. If you have any questions about what's going on around here, looking for sermon notes, or just more information, you can visit us online at northcoastchurch.com. We're continuing our One Hit Wonder series, so grab your Bibles as we jump into the Word of God, and we hope you enjoy.
Well, it's the only one chapter book in the entire Old Testament. So as we've been going through our one-hit wonders, now we come to it. It's a book probably not many of you have read recently, and many of you have never read. It's called Obadiah, not O-B-E-D, but Obad, B-A-D-I-A-H. And if you want to, you can right now just go ahead and find it in your Bible or on your digital device. And we're going to take a look at what this book has to say to us. We don't really know very much about the author. We only know his name. He was a prophet. He spoke the word of the Lord to the children of Israel. But we don't know anything about him. We know why he wrote. He wrote because Israel had been decimated. It was in one of its seasons of spiritual discipline that God had told them would happen. After they moved into their promised land, he said, I am your God and you're my people. But if you live like you're not my people and you live in high-handed disobedience to me, I'm going to allow the surrounding nations to conquer you until you learn your lesson. Kind of a hyper-spiritual timeout, if you will. And they were in the midst of one of these. And their distant cousins, the Edomites, were part of the problem for them. And so this prophet shows up to really send two messages. One, God has not forgotten you, Israel. When your time of discipline is over, he will restore you and fulfill every promise he has made. And those of you that think you're on top right now, you need to understand God is just using you for his purposes. And Edom, your judgment is going to come, and it's going to come soon. And that's the basic message of the book. Now, the thing is, for us to be able to understand it, we need to get a little bit of a better historical understanding of what was going on. Because as I often remind you, these are real letters to real people in real situations. Real prophets speaking to real people in a real mess. And we often kind of read the Bible not realizing it's a library of 66 books. And we're actually more often than not reading something not written to us, but written for us. And there is a difference. It was written to someone else. We're looking over their shoulder, learning the eternal principles that are found in that book. But there was a real Edom. There was a real Obadiah. There was a real mess that the Israelites were in. And to understand the book that we're going to read, these 20-plus chapters in just a few moments, we need, first of all, to grasp who these people were and what was going on. Because, for instance, if somebody wrote a book today and they talked about, oh, Vista, God's judgment is upon you, or oh, Ramona, the township of Ramona, God does love thee, or whatever it would be, you know, you fast forward 1,000 years or so, and they'd just be hard words to say. We wouldn't realize, oh, yeah, that was totally meaningful to everybody in that situation. So let's step back for a few moments and get a little history of the bad guys, the Edomites at that particular time. As I said, they were close cousin of the Israelites, so let's take a look at how this works. You got a guy named Abraham in your Bible. He shows up Genesis chapter 12, and he is the beginning of the nation of Israel. He lived in Ur of the Chaldees. God said, hey, leave your idols behind, come and follow me. I will make a great nation out of you, though you and your wife have no children at this particular time, many great nations actually. The Messiah is going to come out of you, and I'm going to make, not only a great people out of you, I'm going to give you this land as a possession for you and for all of your people to come. So he had two kids. One was Ishmael and one was Isaac. Now, Ishmael over here on the left was, in biblical terms, is called the child of the flesh. Because God had promised Abraham and Sarah that they would have children, but 25 years later, they still hadn't had children. And Sarah's now hit menopause, and she's going like, this ain't going to work. And in that culture, you could have a surrogate. So she says, why don't you take my handmaiden and have a son with her, and we will raise it as our child. So they kind of felt like, well, God, you'd run out of time. You hadn't kept your word. I guess we've got to help you out in this thing. So they did it. Well, about 14 years later, when Abraham is as good as dead, and his wife is beyond childbearing, a little miracle shows up, Isaac. And he is the child of promise through whom this Messiah and this people group we call Jews today is going to come. Now, Isaac has two children. One of them is a child named Esau. They were twins, fraternal twins, very, very different. But Esau's the firstborn and should have got the birthright and everything. But God had prophesied ahead of time that actually the younger child would be the child of promise through whom the Messiah and this nation was going to come. Once again, it's another story. You read it over and over in the book of Genesis. Not like us. We would never do this. But people would try to help out God because they didn't understand his timetable. So long story short, Jacob comes up with this scheme to be able to get the birthright. And you'll have to just read it in Genesis sometime, maybe this week. Just read through that book. It's a fascinating story. But even a little bit earlier, his older brother Esau, who was a man's man out hunting, came back one day famished. Now, I said they were very different. Esau was this hunter dude, and Jacob, he was on the food channel. And so he was working in the kitchen and helping out his mom and all of this sort of stuff. And he's making a bowl of soup or porridge or whatever. And Esau says, let me have it. And Jacob, forever the schemer, says, well, only if you sell me your birthright for it. And James says, fine, go ahead and have it, and eats the soup. Well, out of that, and out of Esau and Jacob then, come descendants. Out of Esau comes a group of people called Edomites. We're looking centuries later, and this group that we're going to talk about are descendants of Esau. And out of Jacob comes the Israelites. And as I said, they're distant cousins, as it were. When the nation of Israel was led out of its centuries of slavery in Egypt, as Moses is leading them into the promised land, the Lord says, you can't touch the Edomites. They're like distant relatives of yours. But the Edomites, here's what they did. When Moses said, can we pass through your land, not to take it, not to pillage and plunder, but just to go through it, we will pay for everything along the way. The Edomites said, no, you can't do that. We will not let you at all. And remember this ragtag group of slaves that has come out of Egypt, they are met with Edom's army saying, don't you dare try to even go through our place. And that's going to be a part of this story. And then later on, when God judges Israel for its high-handed sin, the Edomites stand back and they just watch as Assyria and Babylon just destroy Jerusalem. And later on, they then go in and loot it in that weakness to take it for itself. So we're going to see they had a series of sins, if you will, in their life. When life was going very well, they became very arrogant. When the Israelites were oppressed and very needy, they became very indifferent. And when the Israelites were very weak, they became very greedy. And these are the three things we're going to see. And the key principle through this entire book is this. It's the law of the harvest. The law of the harvest is what you do, is what you're going to get. And over, we're going to see that as we read through this book. And then we're going to step back after I read the chapters. We're going to explore this law of the harvest. How does it work in our life today? Why did God put this book here and keep it so that we would read an ancient prophecy? What did he want us to learn? He wanted us to learn the law of the harvest. And we will also learn what happens when we find ourselves like the Edomites in a place of great success. When we're around people who are hurting and oppressed and needy, and when we're in a position of power versus weakness, how do we respond? What do we plant in our lives? Because what we plant in our lives at that point will determine what we reap in our lives later. Okay? So that's a bit of a background that I think will make it easier as we try to follow along now and read Obadiah chapter 1, the only chapter. And so here we go, verse 1. The vision of Obadiah. This is what the sovereign Lord says about Edom. Basically, you're going to be destroyed. We have heard a message from the Lord. An envoy was sent to the nations to say, rise, let us go up against her or Edom for battle. See, I'm going to make you small among the nations. You will be utterly despised. Why? You might underline this in verse 3. The pride of your heart has deceived you. You who live in the clefts of the rocks and make your home on the heights, you who say to yourselves, who can bring me down to the ground? Though you soar like an eagle and make your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. You know, if thieves came to you, if robbers came in the night, oh, what a disaster awaits you. Wouldn't they steal as much as they wanted? And if grape pickers came, wouldn't they leave a few grapes? I mean, the thief would just take what they want, not everything. The people who come through your vineyard are going to take the grapes, but there'll be something left. But he says, that's not how it's going to be for you. How low Edom will be ransacked, his hidden treasures pillaged, verse 6. On top of that, here's what's going to happen. All your allies will force you to the border. Your friends will deceive and overpower you. Those who eat your bread will set a trap for you, but you will not even detect it. You won't see it coming. In that day, declares the Lord, will I not destroy the wise men of Edom, those of understanding in the mountains of Esau? Oh, you warriors of Teman, you think you're so strong? You're going to be terrified, and everyone in Esau's mountains will be cut down in the slaughter. Now, to understand what he talks about, the high place and their power and all of that, I want to show you a couple of pictures of Petra, which is the center of where they were and why they felt so secure. This was the entrance into that place. Okay? So can you imagine you're a marauding army and you want to take them on? It's okay. Everybody get in single file. Would you agree with me that would be rather easy to defend? And that was part of their whole arrogance in their success and all of this. And here's another picture, just shows you kind of the hill country and everything that was going on in terms of where they lived and why they had this sense of security and why he keeps talking about your strongholds. You think you're like an eagle, you're all so high. And he says, you have no clue what is about to come. So with that said, let's go back now to Obadiah and pick it up in verse 10. Why is this all going to happen to you? You've been arrogant, but in particular, here's what you did. Verse 10, because of the violence against your brother Jacob, the descendants of Jacob, the Israelites, you're going to be covered with shame and you will be destroyed forever. What did they do? Verse 11, on the day you stood aloof while strangers carried off his wealth and foreigners entered his gates and cast lots for Jerusalem, you were like one of them. You might underline that phrase, you stood aloof. In their oppression and in their weakness, you just stood by indifferently watching it happen. And he says, you know what? You might as well have been a part of it. Verse 12 talks about you shouldn't gloat over their misfortune and all this. And then look at verse 14 and then move up just a sentence, the end of verse 13, where he says also, you should not have seized their wealth in the day of their disaster. So in their weakness, you followed up and you seized their wealth, you looted it because you said, oh man, I can have this. That's that third of the things that they planted that came back to become fruit they didn't really want to eat or to experience. Now look at verse 15. This is a key verse in the whole book. Circle the little number on it in your Bible. Mark it up. The day of the Lord is near for all nations. As you have talked to me, what? Done. It will be what? Done to you. Your deeds will return upon your own head. And just as you drank on my holy hill, so all the nations will drink continually. They will drink and drink and be as if they had never been. Verse 17, but on Mount Zion, which is Jerusalem, the capital of Israel, there will be deliverance. It's not now, but it will be holy. And Jacob which is, remember, the father of all those Israelites. Jacob will possess his inheritance. Jacob will be a fire and Joseph a flame. Esau, you'll be stubble. And they will set him on fire, destroy him. There will be no survivors from Esau. The Lord has spoken. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to read the rest of this, these couple of verses, but it just picks up this same idea. God's going to keep all of his promises to the nation of Israel, and God's going to carry out all of his threats to the people of Edom. So there we have it, an ancient, thousands of year old prophecy now fulfilled. The Edomites don't exist anymore. Their place is nothing more than a tourist attraction. But again, why is it in the Bible? Why did God say, I want you to print this one and keep it here, when we know there were tons of other things that were prophesied throughout the centuries? Because God wanted to leave for us this universal principle and make sure we understand it and leave for us this example, the law of the harvest. What you do is what you'll get, and what you've done is what's going to be upon your head. So on your note sheet, you might take it out, and let's talk for a few moments about this thing called the law of the harvest. The law of the harvest shows up in two things we need to remember. Number one, we will always eventually get what we give. We will always, eventually, you might even jot that into your note sheet, eventually get what we give. Why? Because God has taken notes on how we live. Did you know that? He's not taking notes like Santa to see who's naughty and nice or whatever. He's very aware of that. There's a special sense in which God is taking notes on how we respond to others, because the assumption is that's how we want others to respond to us. Circle on your note sheet, Matthew chapter 7, verse 2. It follows a passage that says, judge not lest you be judged, which taken by itself is nonsensical, because the Bible tells us over and over to be fruit inspectors, judge this, judge that, whatever. But in that passage, when we take the whole thing, he's not saying never make a judgment. He's saying be slow to make a judgment and be careful how you judge, because here's what verse 2, chapter 7, verse 2 says, the measure you use is the measure that will be used on you. So if you look at people who are weak and you respond this way, God's going to go, oh, I guess that's how you want the response to be. If you look at people who are in need and you say, oh, God's going to go, oh, that's how you want me to respond to you. When people do you wrong, what kind of mercy do you give them? God says, okay, that's the kind of mercy I'm going to have other people give you, and I will give to you. It's the law of the harvest. God says, one of my principles is what you do is what you're going to get. And by the way, it is such a powerful principle that it finds its way into virtually every religion and every philosophical system. There's some version, you know, of what we today call karma. And biblical karma isn't exact, because we have a Jesus Christ who paid for our sins, right? We have a Lord we can confess our sins to. As I love Jeremiah chapter 18, where it talks about we can so mess up by our behaviors what God is trying to make out of our lives on the potter's wheel, he'll just squish it down and remake it into something different. Part of the Christian message is there is the opportunity to be remade into someone else. There is the opportunity for forgiveness. But the general principle of life that is just observed pretty much everywhere is actually we're going to get what we give. And what's weird is I think it's so written on the hearts of mankind, we all kind of realize that. But the weird part is, like you, I forget it in the day-to-day decisions. If you want to sit down and have a little philosophical discussion, I go, yeah, you know, it just kind of comes back, you know, and we all see that and understand it. But when you do something that ticks me off, somehow it's not right in front of me. I just forget it. Are you like that? That's just kind of how we are, and why we need to understand this principle of the law of the harvest. You see it over and over in God's judgment. I think a couple of famous stories. You have King David and David and Goliath, fame, David and Bathsheba, infamy. After he had taken Uriah's wife and had Uriah killed and done all of these things in private, when the judgment came upon David's life, God said, these same things that you did in private are going to be done to you in public. Or I think of Abraham. Remember, God always draws straight lines with crooked sticks. Those of you who are new at following Jesus, reading the Bible, man, I want to tell you, the heroes are hardly heroes. You know, it's God is the hero of this story, not the people. And Abraham, when he found himself in a very difficult situation, was afraid for his life against Abimelech, a king. And so he told a half lie to get out of the trouble. Now, the next generation, what you do is you have his son Isaac telling another king named Abimelech, kind of like Pharaoh, a general name for the person in power, when he was afraid, not a half-truth, half-lie, telling a whole lie to a stranger. And then you go to the third generation, and what do you have? You have Jacob, the guy we were talking about, telling a flat-out lie to his dad to steal his brother's inheritance. What you do is what you get. Now, a little sidebar here. Parents, what we do is what we're going to get. Not what we tell our kids to do, but what we do. Number one, they are always far more aware of what we do than we think they are. I've said this many times, that when our church was small and I could counsel and you'd ask people, hey, tell me a little bit about your family of origin, they would always tell me stuff about their parents. Their parents had no idea they knew. And for us to somehow think that's not true of us and our own children is to be absolutely foolish. And so what happens is we'll tell our kids, hey, tell them I'm not here, wink, wink, okay? Hey, I'm going to call in sick to work. And what happens is our kids pick up our behaviors but not our boundaries. They pick up our behaviors but not our boundaries. And then later on, I'm just absolutely aghast. Like, why did you tell me you were at the library when you were at that party? How could you lie to me? And if the kid was truthful, the answer would be very simple. Oh, easy, Dad, you taught me. You gave me a PhD. Well, what do you mean? I would never lie to my dad. No, Dad, you lied. I'll figure out the boundaries. You just show me the behavior. That's why when the Bible talks about sins of the fathers being visited upon the children, it's sometimes the consequences of it, but more often it's the behavior is picked up. What we do is what we are going to get. And what we... It's just going to happen every time. Eventually, we're going to get what we give. Now, there's a second principle about the harvest, and it is this. The harvest seldom comes up overnight. The harvest seldom comes up overnight. You know, only a fool plants a garden and 3 weeks later tears it out. You know, like, where are those apples? You got to wait a little bit, right? But we can so easily do that. The principle here is this. God keeps every promise and carries out every threat. He is not one who speaks empty. He's not a liar. Every promise he keeps, every threat he carries out. But it's going to be on his timetable, not on ours. And that means this. You might write this little phrase down. We will live most of our life in the in-between time. That's where we live most of our life, in between planting and harvesting. And the longer that wait is, the more we forget the principle of the harvest. And we can so easily make a couple of mistakes. We can equate delayed consequences with no consequence. Right? That's so easy to do. Hey, man, it seems to be working out okay. Nothing's really happened here. It's like it's all right. And then 10 years later, 20 years later, all hell breaks loose. We're going, what's up with that? That was the old me. Yeah, but this is what you planted. In our culture, we've been seeing that over and over. People who decades ago did things, and then suddenly it's coming to fruit. Many of those people completely changed by now, just wondering like, well, how is that happening? Why would that come up? We will harvest what we plant, which is part of the reason, man, we got to run to the cross with some of the crap we've planted. Amen? It's like, Lord, would you take this? You know, I'm nailing that to the cross. That's, you cry out, it is finished, because all of us have planted along the way stuff we don't want to harvest. But it's so easy to think a delay in consequence is equal to no consequence. And then the flip side is this. It's easy to assume a delay in reward means no reward. Lord, I've done the right thing. Like, how come I'm not getting all the fruit of it right now? Abraham did the right thing when he left and followed God. And 25 years later, he was still waiting. Where's this kid? And as I said earlier, he was as good as dead and his wife was past childbearing. Completely, like, well, no reward. And God says, oh, no, I got a reward. It's kind of interesting. We'd all love to have a miracle in our life, wouldn't we? Wouldn't it be cool to have a miracle? But here's what you need to understand. You can't have a miracle without a mess. Right? What we want is we want miracles without the mess that precedes the miracle. And story after story in the scripture is about God's timing not being our timing. A circle on your note sheet. We don't have time to look at it because there's so many references today. But circle Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. And listen to what it says. Let us not become weary in doing good. Why? For at the proper time, we will reap harvest if we do not give up. The harvest isn't guaranteed if you walk away from the farm. Hold on there in proper time if we do not give up. So I want to spend the rest of our time today. I want to go back to the Edomite thing that we talked about. Their arrogance, their indifference, their greed. And I don't want to do a Bible study here where we talk about Edomites. The dudes aren't even alive anymore. As I said last weekend and often say, I don't want this to be binocular so we can see all the people out there who are arrogant, who are indifferent, who are greedy. I want us to use scripture as we're taught to use it as a mirror. And God put it here so we could ask ourselves, or like, what am I planting here? What does this scripture say about the choices, the decisions, and the actions that we're making today? So let's step back and look at the three major things in the Edomites' life. What they did when they had success, what they did when they crossed those with need, and how they responded when they found weakness. So in your note sheet, the first thing we want to look at is this, under what am I planting? When you and I experience success, which of these two things do we respond with? Pride or humility? See, the Edomites had incredible success at that period of time, and what they responded with was pride. And at any time you and I go through success in life, we have the choice to cast the seeds of pride or to cast the seeds of humility. And the harvest principle is this: God pulls down the proud and lifts up the humble. That's the harvest principle under pride or humility. The Bible is quite clear that God pulls down the proud. Your pride has deceived you, as he says. And he lifts up the humble. In James chapter 4, verse 6, which is on your note sheet, James 4, 6, it says, God opposes the proud and shows favor to the humble. Now, we got a little bit of a problem here. And here's the problem. Our cultural definitions of pride and humility aren't very in line with the biblical definitions of pride and humility. And so we need to understand the kind of pride God says, this is what I hate, this is what I tear down, and not substitute it with kind of some of the definitions for pride and humility that are in our culture today. So let me take a few moments and define for us pride and define for us humility. First of all, pride is not thinking or saying that you excel at something, okay? You don't have a pride problem when you think you're good at something, or you actually let somebody know you're good at something, or you have a trophy and you actually put it out instead of hiding it under the bed somewhere. But in our culture, that's often seen as pride. Like, oh, you should never, we call it bragging, do we not? Well, it's bragging if it's not true. It's truth, just telling the facts, if you can back it up. There is no biblical sense of saying, you know, you don't want to tell your sixth grade kid who's the fastest runner in her class, and people ask her, are you fast? Oh, yeah, I'm the fastest runner, with just a smile on their face. They're so proud of it. And go, oh, don't be proud, don't be proud. No, the Bible in Romans 12:3 says, we shouldn't think more highly of ourselves than we ought, but we ought to think with sound judgment. Now, if that delight is a putting down of others, that's a different thing. But to feel good about what you've accomplished, to look in the mirror and know what you're good at, or in a time and a place to, with joy, share it, is not biblical pride that God has a problem with. Here's what God has a problem with. It's an inflated view of myself that does two things. Number one, looks down on others. And number two, puts my desires and interests first. You can have a whole trophy display case in your house. You could show it to Jesus when he showed up, and he wouldn't go, oh, shame on you. No. But what you never want to do is find yourself thinking you're better than others in the way that you look down on them, or in the way that, well, hey, I'm better than you, so I deserve the best seat, the biggest piece. I'm going to make myself first because I'm first. Those are two things the Bible talks about. On your note sheet, there's a passage there, Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 to 17. And it's six things the Lord hates, yea, seven. And the first one in that list, if I ask a bunch of, like I'm at a pastor's conference or something, and people who are like Bible scholars, I'll say, what's the first thing God says in his list of I hate it? And they'll answer pride. And I will almost always go, no, that's not what it says. Because literally, it doesn't use the word pride. It says haughty eyes, looking down on others. There's a parable in the book of Luke, chapter 18, where two guys go up to pray, and one is an absolute loser. And he says, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. And Jesus says, yep, his prayer is answered. And the other guy, here's how Jesus describes him. He was confident in his own righteousness, and he looked down on everyone else. So he goes in, and he prays this. Lord, I thank you. I'm not like this sinner loser dude over here. I thank you that I don't steal, I don't rob, that I give a tenth of everything I get, that he goes through this whole litany of all the things he does. And guess what? Everyone he describes is true. But Jesus says his prayer went nowhere. His problem wasn't that he did all those good things. His problem wasn't that he told people that he did those good things. His problem was he looked down on people who didn't do what he did. You catch that difference? It's haughty eyes. And a lot of times we can think, well, you know, pride's not that big of a deal. But what we don't understand is the definition of looking down on others is so common when we have measures of success. Let me give you some real life examples. Go from preaching to meddling. Have you ever noticed that rich people think they're smarter in every area of life? Right? Not just they know how to make money or keep it, they know everything. Have you ever noticed people with a good education who do really well in it tend to think they know everything about everything? Have you noticed people that rise up and are very successful in a chosen thing? They have a tendency to look at other people and say, well, you know what? If you were just as dedicated as I am and worked as hard as I did, you too would have all of this. So I'm better than you and you're worse than me. That's why you don't have it. That is our natural human response to almost any blessing we have in life, to think that somehow we earned it, not we received it. I love the athlete who thinks they're a self-made person, right? Well, I'll give you the star athlete who makes it to the top. They usually work incredibly hard, usually a lot harder than everybody else along the way. But come on, let's be honest. They started out on third base. They won the gene pool race. And it doesn't matter how hard you worked, how much you pursued it or whatever, you ain't ever going to do what they're able to do. And yet they just kind of have this sense like, well, I'm better. When we plant that sense of thinking we're better, looking down on people who don't know the theology we know, don't have the education we do, the success we do, the money we do, the type A personality we do. You fill it in. Here's what God is going to do in the law of harvest. He's going to pull you down. Guarantee it. Maybe not today, but he's going to pull you down. Because God opposes the proud, and he lifts up the humble. Well, what about this idea of the second thing I said is we put ourselves first? Let me give you an illustration that proves it. You ever been coming out of a like really jammed parking lot at some event, like North Coast Vista? And like somebody wants to cut in front of you, and they just kind of like jam their way in. Come on, what's our first thought? Our first thought is like, who do you think you are? Right? I mean, that's like you start to creep in, like you own this place. I'm going to creep in because I'm like, who do you think you are? You think you're more important than me? Well, actually, that's what Jesus says. We got to live our life that way. In the book of John, he takes on the lowly role and washes the feet of all the other guys. And he says, as I have done, now you go and do to others. Here's the key. Let me give you the definition of humility, because it's the flip side of this one. Humility is treating others as if they are more important than you. Pride is treating others as if you're more important than them. Humility is treating others, catch this, circle this phrase, as if the disciples were not more important than Jesus. And I mean, he made it quite clear. He said, I'm God. Okay, that's kind of a little bit of bragging, right? Like, I am God, I am your Lord, I am your master, and I just wash your feet, now you wash everybody else's. He treated them as if. So in the little things of trying to get rid of that, I'm the center of the universe, there are just little practices that, like, I try to do in my own life, just give you some of them as, like, stepping stones you figure out your own. But, man, if I'm at a potluck, you ever notice, like, I get there, this might be a newsflash to some of you, I like food. This. And I'll get there and I'll go, oh man, that looks so good. Well, what do I want to do in the flesh? I want to make sure I'm first in line because it looks really good and I deserve it. But what do you do if you have a guest of honor at a party? Do you say, I'm so glad you're here, happy 50th anniversary, 40th birthday, you know, whatever it would be, but excuse me, I'm going to go get my food. Of course not. You give them the first place. You treat them as if they're more important because it's their day. And what humility does is it goes through life putting the needs and interests of others as more important than our own, whether or not they are. So it's like stepping back and going, well, I guess I'll have to buy some when I get home because it'll be gone when I get there. It's stepping back and letting the person that is trying to cut in, it's pretending for a moment they actually are more important than me. I know who you are. You are, fill in the blank, as someone you think is important. See, everything would change then, wouldn't it? Philippians, the passage on your note sheet for this is Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 9. And it reads this way. Do nothing out of selfishness or empty conceit, pride, but with humility of mind, what do? Put the needs and interests of others as more important than your own. In fact, you ought to have the same attitude in you that was in Jesus Christ, who though existed in the form of God and was God, what did he do? He emptied himself, became a man, went all the way to the cross, treating us as if we were more important. And then it ends, therefore the Heavenly Father highly exalted him. The law of the harvest with pride and humility is this. God tears us down when we're prideful, and he lifts us up when we are humble. How do I respond to success? I'm either planting pride, oh, I'm better than you, I deserve the first and the best, or I plant, you know what, I'm going to treat you as better. I'm going to put your needs and interests first. I get to decide whether I get pulled up or push down. And when I decide God's not going to pull me up, I better pull me up. What I don't understand is eventually He's going to push me far further down than I even started, the law of the harvest. Let's look at the second one. When I come across those in need, what do I plant? When I come across those in need, do I plant indifference or compassion? The Edomites just kind of stood aloof and watched it all happen. Remember that verse we read? And that's what it can do. And here's the harvest principle for indifference and compassion, if you want to jot it down. The harvest principle for indifference and compassion is this. If we are indifferent to the needs of others, God will be indifferent to our needs. If we are indifferent to the needs of others, God will be indifferent to our needs when we cry out to Him. Now that sounds kind of harsh, doesn't it? Would you agree with me? Like, whoa! We'll circle and read later this week, Proverbs 21:13. Whoever shuts their ears to the cry of the poor, so I choose, it's not my problem. It's a government problem. It's somebody else's problem. It's whatever. Shut my ears to the cry of the poor. Here's what will happen. They will cry out, and they will not be answered. The law of the harvest, Proverbs 21:13. So, like we did with pride and humility, let me give you biblical definitions of indifference and biblical compassion. Because once again, our culture can define them differently than the Bible does. Indifference is simply this. It's choosing to ignore those in need. It's a choice, and I choose to ignore those in need. I can rationalize it a million ways, but it's a choice. I see the need, and I say, you know what? I'm going to plant indifference. That's the seed I'm going to throw down. He who shuts his ears to the cry of the poor. Notice, that's an active decision choice. Proverbs 28:27 says, those who close their eyes to them. It's a choice. Biblical compassion is this. It's choosing to help those God puts in my path. Now catch this distinction. Biblical compassion is choosing to help those God puts in my path. Biblical compassion is not a bleeding heart that tries to help everyone and everything. Everybody who finds a way to get into my life, everybody who finds a way to have a publicity campaign or a marketing thing or whatever, that you can choose to be helpful or not in that. But the difference between indifference is God has put that person, that situation in front of you in your day-to-day life, and we choose to help or not help, to plant compassion or to plant indifference. And the key question is not, do they deserve it? The key question is, do they have a need? There's this extreme that says, well, man, you need to meet every need out there. You can never do that. Jesus himself said the poor will be with you always. And then there's this pendulum swing that says, well, I don't want to ever be taken advantage of, so we just shut our ears and we shut our eyes. Every time God brings a coworker, a neighbor, a friend, someone in our growth group, whatever it would be, we have the chance to plant indifference or plant the seeds of compassion. And the seeds of compassion help. Now, a little sidebar. Yes, there are boundaries, okay? In our culture, we call it enabling. You know what I mean when you hear that phrase? And I like to make this distinction because the Bible talks about helping those who want to hand up, not those who want to hand out, okay? The ones who want to hand out, whether they created the mess they're in of their own doing or terrible choices, whatever, they're saying, will you help me get up? And our job is absolutely, we will help you get up. Famous story of a good Samaritan. That's what happened there. Then there are those who say, well, will you just get me through today and I'll be back tomorrow, another one and another one. And when we help them, what we are is simply enabling them to stay there in that situation forever. It's as if God says, you live a certain lifestyle, these things are going to happen, and God's given a nice swat in the butt, and then we're sticking a pan in the pants. And there's no pain, there's no lesson to be learned there. It's called enabling. But please, if you're going to make a mistake, make the mistake on enabling, not the mistake on closing your ears. Okay? I'd rather stand before the Lord and find out I helped some people. You didn't really help them, you hurt them. Rather than, well, I didn't want them to do that ever, is that I close my ears to those and my eyes to those who were genuinely hurting. And by the way, for those of us that, you know, do the hand out thing sometimes, I want to tell you, here's what's going to happen 100% of the time. Those who get a hand up are going to be grateful. Those who get a hand out are going to turn on you. They're going to turn on you the moment the well runs dry. That's what they do. But don't worry about it, because the reward doesn't come from people praising you. The reward comes from the Lord and the fruit that he gives you, right? But every time, success, I can plant pride or humility. Needs, I can plant indifference or I can plant compassion. Well, the last one is when I come across weakness. I have the choice there of planting one of two things. Greed or generosity. What the Edomites did is they stood aside, they saw all that had happened, and they said, oh, this is our opportunity. And in the weakness of the Israelites, they went in and raided their people and their stuff. And the harvest principle, if you want to write it down, for greed and generosity is this. The harvest principle is greed is like drinking salt water to quench your thirst. Greed is like drinking salt water to quench your thirst. Greed leads to greater thirst and greater poverty. Again, I wish we had longer today for all of these passages, so you just have to look them up. But Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 10 says this, whoever loves money, not has money, not wants money, loves money, never has enough. And whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. There's always more. Why? Because they're trying to quench their thirst with salt water. Now, come on. Would you rather win the lottery or lose the lottery? How many would rather win it? How many would rather lose it? We have counseling. Okay. Yeah. Well, why would we all want a little more money? By the way, there's nothing wrong. You know, greed is not wanting more. Greed is organizing your life around getting more. Those are two different things. Why do we want more money? Because we think that money will buy us stuff that will make life better and happier, right? And here's the truth, that when you get money because God has blessed you with money, it's got a lot of good things. The Bible has nothing against money. The Bible has everything against the love of money, against the greed and its twin brother stinginess that is organized around getting and keeping and never sharing. Because he says when we do that, we have no idea that everything we thought the money would give us, it won't give us. We've all seen rich people who are incredibly generous and incredibly happy along the way. And we've seen rich people whom we wouldn't trade anything except for their bank account with them. Because the fruit of greed is usually a destroyed marriage, it's jacked up kids, it's a ton of conflict. Read the verses on your note sheet later this week. I spell a bunch of them out. And in every negotiation, in every situation, in every time we're stronger, we're weaker, we get the opportunity to choose. Am I going to plant greed and its twin stinginess? Or am I going to plant generosity? Quick to share. Doesn't mean I give it all away. It means I quick to share. If I share generosity, the Lord says he will be generous with me. The thirst will be quenched. If I plant greed and stinginess, everything I think I'm getting is everything I'll never have. Obadiah. Bet you never read it before, most of you. I encourage you to read it again. Talk about it in your life group this week as we take a look at why God put this letter in here. Because of the law of the harvest. It's real. And I just encourage you to take the three areas that we looked at today that come right out of this text and the Edomites' mistake and ask some hard questions. How am I responding to my success? How am I responding to those who are in need? And how am I responding to opportunity and weakness? Plant the right stuff, and you're going to love the harvest. Father, would you take the things that we've looked at and help us to live a life that brings glory and honor to you, the ultimate one who was so generous to us beyond what we could ever imagine. To the glory of Jesus, amen.
Well, as always, we'd love to connect with you. If you have a question, comment, or even a prayer request, we'd love to hear from you. You can send it in at info@northcoastchurch.com. We'd also like to thank you for your continued generous support. If you'd like to give, you can donate through our website or our North Coast Church app. We hope you were challenged and encouraged by this week's message, and we'll see you next week.